pronounced Jones. We are live. And this is Jim Meskimen. Hi. And this is my semi-irregular podcast or broadcast, whatever you want to call it, called It Could Be Voice. It Could Be Voice, which is about the voice, the human voice. I interview authors, other narrators like myself, audiobook narrators, voiceover artists, animation people. And today I have a special guest, a man I just met who's been nice enough to come on. We hit it off very well, and I think you'll enjoy our conversation. I know I will, and perhaps he will too. Dialect coach Thom Jones.
Hello, everybody.
Welcome.
Thank you for having me, Jim.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Gosh, well, I read a little bit about you. And of course, we worked together on a project about which we can say very little, but it was a lot of fun. And I instantly grokked that you are similar to me and that you have just a very practiced ear when it comes to dialects and accents. I wanted to ask you first thing is something, a question I don't know the answer to, which is dialects, accents, what's the difference?
Well, I mean, you know, the two terms are used interchangeably by just about everyone, including people, you know, that are dialect coaches.
That should know better.
But if we were going to get very, you know, technical with it, and there's play within this as well, you know. I have a linguistic background, but I'm not a linguist. So, you know, you may want to ask a linguist specifically, like somebody who's like a doctor of linguistics to weigh in on this. But my understanding is that dialects belong to, you call something a dialect if it is the person's language from birth, you know, their language that they grew up, learned from infancy or, you know, when they were first learning how to talk, and the, you know, their primary language that they speak. Everybody has, you know, there are many, many different ways of speaking English, and those are all dialects of English. An accent is when you are speaking a language that is not your own. You would say somebody speaks, you know, French accented English, right? But we really interchange the terms, you know, all the time. And people just, you know, even my clients would say, are you going to work with me on my accent? And they're actually doing a dialect, but they'll call it an accent. And I'm fine with that. We all know what we mean.
You don't hit them with a ruler.
No, I don't. No,
that's good. No. That shows a lot of patience.
No, those days have passed. I grew out of that. Those days have passed.
Now, Thom, you are from somewhere in Florida, I read.
Is that right? Yeah, I'm originally from, I grew up in West Palm Beach, Florida. I was born in North Carolina. I had two American parents, I should say, to be more specific, because there are many places with a South.
And almost every place has a South.
Americans tend to say Southern, and that, you know, like, you know, because we put ourselves at the center of everything, don't we? So it's sort of like, okay, let's say American South, or an American Southern dialect. And both of my parents had those dialects. My father had a coastal Virginia dialect, and my mother had a mountain Tennessee Southern kind of a sound. Wow. So it's sort of like they kind of covered the two Southern American extremes, you know, among, you know, the possibilities of dialects, that sort of coastal thing, which is like, you know, the sort of traditional Southern accent that sort of, you know, kind of effete. And then, you know, in my mother's family, there's people that talk like that.
That's so funny. My wife's people are mainly from Maryland and North Carolina. So they too are very, you know, I met her grandmother, and her grandmother was just as charming as all get out, and a lovely little Southern belle. You could just imagine her with an apron on and putting a pie in the window.
Totally. And then my grandma, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, I was just going to say her folks, my wife's folks, the Shockleys, are from Maryland, St. Michael's, Maryland, and they have a very interesting. Hard for me to parse. I've heard it many times, but to duplicate it is very difficult. But it's very particular Eastern Shore.
Yeah, Eastern Shore. You know, yeah.
People around there, they go, you know, and you. Going out and you like cool. The word R is really pronounced in a strange way.
Yeah, it's a fascinating dialect, and it sort of it also relates a bit to Philly and Pittsburgh as well. They share some sounds, but yeah, I spent some time with that dialect on a production, and it's really very particular. It's sort of a wonderful mishmash between the north, of the U.S. and the south of the U.S. It's really a meeting point. So you kind of have sounds from both places intermingling. And so you can sort of go, well, it kind of sounds like a rural sort of country accent. And then it's got some hard lines in it that sort of sound a bit more like it's of a city almost. That's curious. It's a curious dialect.
I want to talk a little bit, ask you a little bit. I don't want to talk. I want you to talk about your upbringing, how you wandered into this career, because you're at the top of your field in a very slender channel. And it's interesting to see how one gets there. Did you start off to be with that in mind, or did you find it to discover that?
No, I mean, I could go so specific, so I'll just try to keep it somewhat general. I was always wanted to do something creative. I started painting and drawing at a very young age. And so it was mainly going to be about that. Then at a certain point, they discovered that I could sing really well. And so then I was doing a lot of singing.
They meaning the authorities?
My folks. And, you know, and then always, you know, kind of planting me in the middle of the room
reciting things
to belt it out, and always receiving that, you know, kind of feedback, especially from my mother, to sing louder, sing louder, sing louder. So I have a substantial singing voice, and meaning it's loud. Yeah. And
can I go back a click and ask you, again, a similarity with me is the painting and drawing. I grew up painting and drawing also. That was my first profession.
I think
What kind of thing did you like to do?
The drawing? Well, I mean, it was just all kinds of drawing at first. And then there was a painting teacher who lived across the street from us and had a studio in her garage apartment. And all the neighborhood kids went and studied oil painting with this, you know, fine artist. And she taught us about, you know, shadows and light and how to mix color and how to, you know, like I was painting in oils at the age of 7 and continued, you know,
with confidence and
if you looked at me now, you're like, that's pretty good for somebody who's 7, but I got pretty good, and I thought that's what I wanted to do. But I think it has informed the way that I listen. I think, you know, as a voice, dialect, text coach, singing coach as well, I think I use a lot of the visual arts in my work in relation to tone, the way you mix color, the structure, all of that's in there when you start to approach words as well.
I totally agree. That's very interesting. I've never met somebody who felt the same way about it. I got to ask you now about this.
Words is a bit more like sculpture too, you know, because you're how things build.
Did you do much sculpture? I have to ask. Or did you not get to that? You got into the singing.
No, I got into right out. And then after the singing, acting, and then I wanted to be a serious actor, and I went away to a boarding school for the arts in high school for 2 years called the Interlochen Arts Academy. And then I went from there to study at an acting conservatory type program, and, you know, got my BFA and studied at Purchase College and studied, you know, that was classical acting training. So then you have your voice class, your speech class, your acting class, your movement class, your clowning class, your fencing class, your, you know, we did all those things.
Did they ever have a how to make a living at it class?
Well, you know, it's so funny in those programs, and I taught at Purchase when, you know, later when I was no longer a student, and then I was the head of voice and speech for Brown University has an MFA program in acting and directing, and I taught there for about 19 years, and that just finished up about a year ago. But I guess, what was my point? I wanted to tell you stuff about myself, but it was more about the art, your question, than my resume.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. So it's interesting. You meandered around, and then you became a person who was, it seems like you had a high tolerance of education, which I respect. I haven't had such a, I've gone kicking and screaming to my education.
I love being in the classroom. Yeah. I love being with students. It's probably my favorite thing, actually.
Oh, sure. I like to help people.
Yeah. And you know, you see the light bulbs, you know, go off, and it's kind of thrilling to watch somebody put something together. And then with voice and speech work, you know, the work you and I did together was, you know, more on a dialect. But if it's voice coaching, that can also be, you know, even though it's not therapy, it can be therapeutic. And a lot of the time, you know, people are freeing their voice. They're coming to a deeper understanding of themselves, of the way their breath works, the way their emotional life connects with their thinking life, and how that's, you know, how you do that with your voice and how you apply that to acting. And that part of the work is really fascinating to me. And you know, I talk about breath a lot with my clients and my students. And of course I also talk about the phonetics and the sounds and what happens with the, you know, here are the phonetics that we use in sort of general American, and these are the phonetics you need to move toward, and all of that stuff is at play. But
Now on that topic, I noticed that in your the thing I read about you on your website, that you conquered the international phonetic alphabet.
I don't think I conquered it.
It said you conquered it.
So. I don't know who said that. I don't think I wrote that about myself.
In fact, you're known, if I'm reading here, it says you are known as the conqueror of, and there's a statue of you. And
okay. All right. Yeah. You go. You do your thing.
So what is the International Phonetic Alphabet anyway?
Okay, so the International Phonetic Alphabet, and now we're going to get into a slightly, you know, okay. So the International Phonetic Alphabet is an alphabet of symbols, and the symbols, it was established by some very well-educated, extremely wealthy, white British men back in the mid 19th century, I believe, maybe even a little earlier. Also, some French linguists were involved as well, I believe. And I'm sure there'll be a lot of people who say he doesn't have that exactly right. So there you go. This is
okay. So they on the show? They're not on the show.
Anyway, but this is what I kind of, you know. And they established a way to basically notate any sound that we make in any language.
So it's akin to musical notation that allows us to
communicate
a particular sound that can be done.
And they're symbols. Some of them look like letters, and some of them look like, you know, Greek letters, and some of them look, you know, they were made to, the symbols somewhat represents the shape of the sound.
Oh, okay. And, how many are there?
Oh, there are, I don't know exactly how many, but there are hundreds. Perhaps even thousands. Yeah. And then there are also these markings that you can do with the symbols to alter them slightly. And those are called diacritical marks. Like I can take a symbol, like there's a symbol for the sound. I'll write this on a, like an envelope here for you.
All right.
And I like to say envelope, not envelope, because it envelops, right? So, but both ways of saying that are acceptable. And you know, who decides what's acceptable and what isn't is a whole nother show.
Right.
This symbol,
well, it's
right?
Cute.
Isn't it?
It's
so
cute.
This symbol that not don't look at this part. This the part here. Okay. Right. So this symbol is the symbol for all, as in law, right? And in American English, we don't round as much as you would say in, you know, British English, right? So
law.
This would go rounder, and I can kind of, you know, I can do a diacritical mark for rounding it more. Although if you were a British person and you saw this, you would simply interpret that as all, and an American would interpret it as all, right? But, you know, if I was...
It's where that drawing skill comes
in. If I added that to the bottom, then that means I round my lips more, right? And I round them forward.
So, it looks just like a little lip.
Right, exactly.
This is like learning Chinese characters. You know,
well, you know, and the thing is, these are really useful. It's a kind of a framing device. There is room for interpretation with them. It's very complex because, There's just, you know, it's politically complex because there for a very long time in there was sort of a standard speech that actors had to learn that related to the speech of the Northeast of the U.S. If you were an American actor, you know, in the 30s, 40s and 50s and somewhat into the 60s, and even in my training, maybe you might even know of it from yours. But there was you had to kind of get rid of your regionalism and you had to speak in kind of, you know, a standard American type of speech. The problem with that was standard of who is setting the standard, and this standard, the IPA, was established by, as I had mentioned, these sort of rich white guys in England that, you know, were really well educated and, you know, basically speech nerds. And they wanted to figure out a way to put this all together. But they said, you know, their idea of neutral was, you know, the way that they spoke. So, right. So then
why don't we make a rule that everyone needs to speak more, you know, or less the way we do?
Yes. If you're going to speak English properly, then you must speak it this way. And yeah. So then there's a whole judgment on that. And you think about, okay, so that's colonialism. That's, you know, wealthy white men that are, you know, a part of, you know, a nation that is occupying the world and are a huge part of it at that time anyway.
Yeah.
And, you know, so there's a lot of baggage in relation to this particular stuff, but at the same time, it's also just a really useful tool. And so we kind of, you know, I just make sure I always talk about the baggage as well.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So that we don't stay stuck in a place where we continue this harmful idea that there's a proper way to speak.
Right.
You know,
right.
there's just, do you communicate clearly and do you get your point across? And if you 100%. Do, then you've been successful.
100%. And to go back to your painting analogy too, there's no what's the best color? You know, well, no, there's a lot of different colors. It's completely subjective. It's art. And even language is kind of an art. It has developed into a precision art, but it is the art of, you know, an aspect of the art of communicating. It's all the different colors on the palette and all the different colors you can mix out of those colors.
Yes. Yes.
So, yeah.
So, you know, we used to teach, okay, first you have to, you know, come to the speech class and you have to get rid of your regionalism and you have to speak in this kind of, you know, generic American theater standard speech, or, you know, some people refer to it as broadcast speech, or, you know, it has a lot of different names.
It's not mid-Atlantic though. That
Mid-Atlantic, goes Mid-Atlantic was one of the names. Mid-Atlantic, or there's also transatlantic. I've heard that term. There are many, many terms for it, but it was essentially the speech that was spoken by really wealthy white, extremely well-educated people in the Northeast. And pretty much everybody spoke that way. I mean, you know, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Eleanor Roosevelt, they, you know, said it's that sort of American speech that nearly sounds British, but doesn't quite.
That's right. It skirts the edges of it and never fully goes British.
Right.
Roosevelt was one of, was like the first celebrity that I was paid professionally to loop another actor in a movie for. And I've done many presidents, but Franklin Roosevelt was the first one. And so what a great voice.
Yeah. December
7th, 1941, a day that will live in infamy.
Yeah. That's great. And you got that vibrato he had. But they all, that was the sort of oration style of the period is, if you spoke, then you would put some vibrato into your voice, which actually kind of helps your voice descend. It also, you know, because that's that vibrato is a connection to your support, right? So then you have more energy in your support.
Oh, yeah.
And it also, it just sends, you know, it sends it out. So
yeah, it's like the guys at the pulpit too. It's like the preachers that they would have been listening to.
Or the old acting style. I mean, if you go back, hear any old recordings of, you know, actors doing Shakespeare back in the early 20th century, you know, they sing it rather than you know, that went out of fashion in the, like in the 50s and 60s, and we started to speak the stuff rather than sing it. But it, you know, it used to be, you know, I can't think of what kind of them, friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears, right? And they were all singing away when they would act.
It's not great
in a way. Sometimes I have students do that just to, like, you know, get the feeling of the emotions riding out, because that's kind of what you've got when you're in a vibrato. It's an emotional thing.
Well, it's like we're saying, it's an aspect of the art. It's a color. It's a wonderful color. It's great for comedy now. Before it was not as comedic. Now we kind of understand it. We've processed it, and we went, yeah, that was a trick. It was great. But now it's just
sound like
corny.
That. Yeah. So, but you know, so I was an actor, a singing actor, and you know, had a good go with that, pretty good go with that. But people kept asking me to teach, and before I knew it, I was, you know, teaching a lot. And then eventually I was kind of like, I think I'm a teacher. I think I like it a lot. So I think I'll just do this. And you know this, I would imagine you can relate to this, but as an actor, you kind of go, is that okay to change your mind? Right. But the great thing is I know a lot about the craft, you know, as a result of having spent, you know, a long time, quite a while being an actor and then coming into the teaching. So I understand how to build a character, you know.
Have you ever done any directing?
A little bit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the theater, mostly.
It's another related skill for sure.
Yeah. But you know, I like my voice and speech coaching thing. I do. I really love it.
Yeah.
I don't know if have you directed at all?
A little bit. Yeah. Mostly audio. I've done hundreds of hours of audiobook directing.
Yeah. Okay.
With multicast, which is kind of like old radio, you know? It's
Then I would imagine, you know, what you would get what I'm saying. And I say, if you feel a little bit like an octopus, it's like you feel like you have to reach in every direction. I was like, oh, can I just like pay attention to the voices and what the voices are doing? And, you know, like whether or not the accent sounds authentic and consistent. And also, does that voice sound like it's truthful, you know, emotionally? Right. Is it speaking the truth?
Oops, I hit the wrong one. Yeah. And that's the most important thing is the story being told.
Yeah.
Are the characters believable? Are we convinced? Are we being pulled along? Is it, you know, are we expressing what the playwright or the author had in mind, or are we diverging and kind of splintering into a lot of like,
right. Totally, man.
So much. I was remembering last night that there was this is kind of off topic. Well, it's not off topic, but it comes out of nowhere. But I remember I went up to Santa Cruz to go to school, Northern California. Mm-hmm. But I'd grown up here in the Valley. I live in Tarzana and I live in the Valley.
Oh, gosh.
And so I actually had this kind of
accent. Did you talk about this type of speech that you're doing right now? Keep going. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you. Keep going.
No, I was just saying that there was this moment when I was like in Santa Cruz, and I think I was taking a road trip back home for some reason. I was talking to people, and I realized I have an accent. It struck me. I don't know. Maybe somebody pointed out to me, dude, you have an accent or something. I'm like, no, I don't. And I'm like, this kind of lazy, weird, funny accent.
It's interesting that accent you're doing right now, you know, kind of belongs to California, right?
But I've heard it all over the place.
But something happened in the 80s. I think I would say in the 80s, you know, with the advent of kind of like the Valley Girl thing, right? You know, when that hit, and Fast Times at Ridgemont High, you know, and everybody was like, oh. And then for some reason through the 90s as well, young people just started to really grab on to that way of speaking. And it's got, you know, it's got, there are two different versions to it. Like, there's the version that's very sort of
vocal fry.
And yeah, it's like lots of glottal fry. And it sort of sounds, and the end of every phrase, you're lifting up. But it's upward inflected, but the intention and the inflection doesn't actually go anywhere to do anything. It just sort of stays with the person who's doing the lifting. You know what I mean? That pitch, usually we use pitch, like even now I'm using some upward pitch with you to throw the ball to the other person to say, are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
Will you pick this up? Will you continue this idea I'm communicating with you? Or are you with my idea?
Yeah.
You talked about your Southern relatives, Southern American relatives earlier. And you know, the tradition in the South is to lift up on the end of what you're saying, like it's a question. Uh-huh. But that's a different type of upward inflection. But this upward inflection we're talking about now is so curious to me because it doesn't involve the other person. So it concerns me. Right. And then we did that version, which, you know, is sort of a very particular thing. And then the version you did is sort of the more sort of like covered up version where it's like kind of, it's like a surfer kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that usually has a very similar pattern to that other pattern, at least.
Right.
And
totally. It's
basically like, I'm not going to be threatening on any level. I'm very chill and down to earth and easy to deal with. I'm
probably high.
I'm not going to land anything I'm saying.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Just going to leave it in a possibility. You know,
this is not the guy that they're going to pick to do the valedictorian speech because
no, and I'm
too uninvolved.
Right. And I also think it sounds a little bit like you're doing this, you know, typing while speaking. It's almost like the speaking is in the rhythm of, you know, because that's another thing that we've had happen in our communicating is that, you know, prior to computers, we weren't on them all the time communicating this way with words.
Right. Yeah, very interesting. Yeah, that raises
to do this, right, with their words. And that's a different thing than this.
Very different. Yeah. Very different.
Yeah, and that affects our rhythm and pitch patterns and all of that.
And our digestion while we're at it.
Right. Yeah.
That raises the question of like... I think about it a lot of where language is going. One thing I like about being an audiobook narrator is that I'm keeping spoken language alive to some degree. And more and more, as you know, we're talking to artificial speakers that don't need to take a breath, speakers that don't really listen. You know, whereas maybe even 10 or let's say 20 years ago, it was kind of like a novelty, like, oh, I think I'm talking to a machine. Now it's like, yeah, okay, what machine am I talking to now? I expect to go, I didn't know a real person to be there. Yeah, I'm sorry. You know, it becomes ubiquitous.
Yeah.
And what's that going to do? You know, because we're already getting very homogenized. Is it going to, I don't know, just kind of an interesting question of where language goes. Obviously, we still need to communicate vocally, and that's not changing. But for instance, one of my jobs is to, as you know, voice match people to do Colonel Sanders or Robert De Niro or Tommy Lee Jones or people like this, you know, and to, and to or Colin Firth. I've done Colin Firth's voice quite often for trailers. I did it for 1917. And
amazing.
Now,
you're good.
Thank you. But now there are, I know that there is software extant that guy can just type it in, type the line in, and they take the fingerprint of Colin Firth, the vocal fingerprint, and Bob's your uncle, you know? So that's an interesting thing as well. I don't know. You have any thoughts about any of this?
Yeah. I mean, I have thoughts about that. Wow. Well, the first thing I wanted to respond to was when you said, you know, how do you feel about that? You know, what do you think that is going to do to all of us, that that talking to those, all those automated voices that we speak to when trying to get service or, you know, I don't know, get a password changed or something. And you're like on the phone for hours with, you know, press three to blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, that's just, you know, I don't know. I use it as a sort of gestalt therapy to let, you know, let feelings out. Practice. I just find that all so irritating. Can't I just speak to a person, right?
Yeah.
But you know, I don't know. I think that language will continue to evolve. Speech will continue to evolve. Even that, you know, upspeak we were talking about a little bit earlier is a development in speech, and it will. It will stay as long as it's useful to society. And on some level, it must be useful to society, and it'll continue to change. I mean, you know, gosh, I always find it so interesting to think about the fact that the way that the English spoke English was drastically changed by, you know, when they had a German royal. And then so they all sort of started dropping their R's and started speaking, you know, our, what we think of as RP is in many ways a German accent.
Really?
So, yeah. It's kind of fascinating. So, you know,
the Habsburgs, yeah, the Habsburgs.
Yeah, that? Yeah. So, you know, like if I talk to you like this and then I go into a German accent right after it, you can hear that it's like, it's very similar.
Yeah, right?
So, I'm kind of going down a rabbit hole here, but I guess what I'm trying to say to you is I know it'll keep evolving. I guess the fear on your part and maybe even a little bit on mine would be, are we going to be replaced by machines if they're able to do this kind of stuff? You know, I don't know. I think there is something that's communicated with the human voice in the moment in a spontaneous way that I don't think computers will ever be able to replace. I think, you know, as long as audiences are interested in seeing something live, right, then that's also in our favor of that not happening. Yeah. And I do, you know, people are always, have always been saying for eons that, you know, oh, the theater is dying, and it never dies.
Neither has opera.
But I don't think it's going to die. I think people love the theater, and I think it'll come back good and strong. And you know, and I think, yeah, I don't think, I think we'll just keep adjusting to it. You know, I heard something about like, they're going to do a concert with a hologram of Whitney Houston or something. And people are going to be able to go watch Whitney Houston live again, except it'll be a hologram. And I'm like, eh, I don't know about that.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll see, whatever.
We'll see. Yeah,
to each his own, right?
To each his own.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I understand. I mean, there's a reason why there aren't tons of venues featuring stuff like the Hall of Presidents at Disneyland. You know, we're kind of aware there's no living person.
It's just
there.
Terrible.
Yeah. And you're from Florida, so you should be the easiest person to please on that one.
I don't know if I quite answered your question. That doesn't really scare me.
I think I just asked you what your thoughts. So I think you got it right. Yeah.
Okay.
I had another little question for, now my mother, actress Marion Ross of Happy Days.
Yeah. That was so cool to find out that was your mom.
Yeah, yeah. She's
people, I'm sure, say, I grew up watching your mom.
Yeah. So did I. Believe me. Yeah, I was watching you. Yeah, she didn't, she didn't see what I was doing. but she loved accents. She got her start in live television with Noel Coward.
Oh, wow. That is so cool.
Live like spirit.
Being Noel Coward?
Or she worked, he directed her, and he was in the production. Oh. It was a live. I finally saw it on YouTube. Now, talk about a person who's talked quickly and had a particular up across the accent. It was just extraordinary.
Yes, that it clipped. Did she play Ruth? Do you know what part she played?
She played the Irish maid.
Irish maid. Yes, there is an Irish maid.
There's an Irish maid who kind of is a comedic beat in the thing. And she was about, I don't know, 24, 25 or something. It's really cute to see her in it. And she played Little Irish Maid. And then she went on, I believe, afterwards to play an Irish maid in Life with Father, which was a live TV show, a series. She always says, with Leon Ames, which these days people go, okay. Leon Ames. But at the time, it's always, she never says Life with Father by itself. It's always Life with Father with Leon Ames. But she used to teach us and did teach us, actually, the Cockney alphabet. Are you familiar with that?
No, tell me about that. That's fascinating.
You should know about this.
Yeah, I should.
So the Cockney alphabet is a kind of a funny way of, I guess, of, I'm sure she never explained it. She just started reciting it. So let's see how much of it I can remember. A is for horses.
Yeah.
B for mutton. C for yourself. D for dumb. You get the idea.
Yeah, I do. Really brilliant.
I forget what E was, but effervescent.
Yeah.
K for Rancis. I'll try to find the whole thing and send it to you because it's just cute as hell. And she would recite that. It must have been something that she learned in college as a way of practicing her Cockney.
Her Cockney accent, sure.
Yeah, but she loved accents, and she would always point one reason why I think I, developed an ear that I have to whatever degree is that she pointed out that people talked, characters and shows and people on the street and people in our lives had different ways of talking, and she would mimic them a little bit, And
you know what's interesting? There's something called an idiolect, right? So there's dialect, but there's idiolect, which is like the way an individual person speaks, right?
Oh,
a dialect
is idiolect, like a group of people.
But an idiolect is the way the individual speaks. And that's a wonderful way to think about all of it, because you can even have, I know within my own family, I have, we have different ways of speaking. I have a sister who says certain words in a completely different way than I do. So you just kind of think, well, every single character I play has an accent or a dialect. What is that? Or an idiolect, right? That is specific to them. What is that? And how do I explore that? And so the teaching has become not that we, it's basically teach the students and the clients to be able to learn anything, right? Here are the tools you need. And, I have three things I focus on primarily, and they are vocal placement, which is also called vocal posture. Some people say the posture of the voice, like how does the voice live in the body, basically?
Mm-hmm.
And then the next thing would be the phonetics, right? The shifts, like the, like all has to go to ah. So instead of saying all talkative daughters, I say all talkative daughters, right? And that changes the shape, right? So then there you go. So that's the next thing. If you just do that, it's not complete. And then people will be very, very aware that you're doing something, right? Huh, it has to also be established in a really strong, clear way in your physicality, in your body. When your body is engaged with the sounds that you're making, then you start to connect with your you know, emotional resonance. And once you connect with your emotional resonance, then yeah, the dialect starts to sound more and more, or the accent or the idiolect starts to sound like it, you know, it's yours, it belongs to you. And then the third thing, so the first thing was vocal posture or placement. Second thing was phonetic sound changes or sound shifts. And the third thing is, you know, rhythm and musicality. And yeah. if you find those three things, then you can, you're on solid ground, right? It's like
I think of musicality a lot, in the kind of work that I wind up doing when I'm listening to other people or putting together a bunch of impressions or something.
Right.
And there's no other way to describe it, because it has to do with this, the way that this wavelength undulates in a particular way. And it's very unique to that person. The idiolect that you're talking to, I think, is to me, it's like, you know, I notice, for example, I've said it before that, you know, you take a really good impressionist. Like, I'm very good at certain voices, very good at, better than other people at, you know, other people are better at theirs. But if you put it side by each with that original, there's a huge disparity.
That's the Rhode Island term.
Side by each. Yeah,
that comes from Rhode Island.
I picked that up from somebody. I like it. I like it. It's just
the French Canadian. It's a French Canadian term.
Alan Thicke was the person who I believe is Canadian. It's the first person I heard say that side by two eggs side by each and a two eggs side by each and a something of toast. I can't remember. Anyway, but if you put my voice next to, let's say I do Tommy Lee Jones pretty effectively. I mean, I definitely match the kind of hollow sound that he has and the sort of disinterested aspect that he has, as well as the accent from San Saba or wherever he is in Texas. But if you put it right next to Tommy Lee Jones, you would see there was a gulf, a huge disparity between those two things.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a good stand-in sort of guy for that. And even quickly, you know, if you heard it next to the original, may not you notice it too well.
Yeah.
But every person is so unique, don't you find?
Yeah. Yeah, and you just said you just said some great things there. It made me think of, you know, when I get asked to help people create real people, like actual people. That's happened in my career now quite a few times. And the thing about doing a biopic or playing, you know, like an iconic character, and you do them all the time yourself, is that what we go after is, we actually, for the actor, we don't go after an impersonation. We go after what I like to call, you know, finding their essence. And I think that's kind of what you're doing too, actually.
Yeah. You know? Maybe pushing it a little more.
Maybe a little bit more, right?
Well, by virtue of the fact that I don't usually have my physicality too much involved. So I have one channel, which is the voice.
Right.
And now if you have an actor who's on stage, they have their whole body and the voice and God knows what else to support.
Right, because that's actually a part of our speaking, you know, our gestural life determines a lot about rhythm and musicality is in the sort of the physical, the
way that it's lives
in the physicality, you know.
I've been a subscriber to Gestural Life magazine so long, I totally agree.
No, I'm so gullible. I was like, oh.
I want to sell you a subscription too.
I was like, I would love that magazine. That sounds so interesting. Right up my alley. Like, why do people move that way? You know?
Let me ask you this. If you're done talking about that particular point, I know I interrupted you. Did you have any more to say about gestural stuff? As I totally agree. There's the way they hold themselves, the way they hold their mouth. We talked about this the other day.
Yeah. The way we speak, whether it be with words or with our bodies, you know, is an expression of the culture that we come from, right? So it's as varied as there are different types of cultural backgrounds, you know? So it's magnificent, actually. You know, and they all tell a story, like, you know, the different ways of speaking is like, okay, you can hear that, you know, you can hear in a Jamaican accent that there's, you know, West African and Irish blending together because of colonization, right? So that, you know, the British basically, you know, did this to the world in some ways. And of course, now the US is kind of doing it. So not kind of, definitely, but you know what I'm saying.
100%.
So, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I just wanted to share that little point.
I think I'm enjoying how you and I can both geek out on these things. It's it's really
cool. I can go on for days. I just love it.
Yeah. And let me ask you this. What is in your job, and we should probably wrap it up here soon. You've given me a lot of your time, but in your job, what is the high point for you? What is the thing that is like the big score for you when you're helping someone?
Oh, I had this experience. This was a high point. Okay. So I was coaching a famous Australian actor to do Schenectady, New York.
Wow.
And this actor did a brilliant job. I think I can say who. I think that's okay. Ben Mendelsohn.
I love Ben Mendelsohn.
Familiar with Ben. Ben's a wonderful, wonderful actor.
Amazing.
And so he was doing his Schenectady and you know, we had had like maybe a day or two on set at this point. And the sound mixer turned to me at one point during the day and went, and he didn't know who Ben was, but he turned to me and said, "My God, you know, that actor does the most amazing Australian accent." And I was like, "Oh my gosh, I can't tell you how you just made my day." And then I went and told Ben, and he was thrilled. And you know, we were just so like, you know, he thought Ben was from Schenectady, you know. And this is like some, you know, somebody on the crew who was, you know, like a local hire, and so that made it even better. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
That's boy, when that's... I met, you know, when people appreciate the work, then I'm happy. You know, I'm not happy when they, in some ways I'm happier if they don't even notice that accents like are happening. I mean, obviously they're going to notice they're happening at first, but I like it when they let it go and just go into the story and go, right. They're speaking in a New York accent. Fine.
Yeah.
And then after that, I hope they don't think about it again. You know, I want them to get lost in the story. And if they're thinking about the accent throughout the piece, then it's actually pulling them out of the story. So the goal is for it to be, you know, seamless. Yeah.
100%. 100%. Yeah. Well, we've got I had a lot of people commenting on things. Thank you very much, Adam.
I would imagine. Thank you, everybody. I hope you enjoyed this.
Yeah, it was really, really cool. I had it was really a kick, and I love working with you, and I respect what you do. So thanks for spending some time with us today.
Thanks. It was a pleasure to be with you. I really had a good time.
Likewise. All right. There you go. Well, for those of you, I'm going to say thank you very much, Thom Jones. We will be hearing your work through the voices of others and not even knowing how connected you are and how much influence you have over our lives. But well done. And thanks again for spending some time with us.
Thank you, Jim. I appreciate you. Take good care.
You betcha.
Bye-bye.
So there you go. There, very interesting topic and very experienced and honed listener there, and a real, real scholar of the voice. That was a real thrill for me. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll be back with more interesting people another time, and be well. Talk to you soon.